asked the brother, everywhere we go, they asked him to come forward. This brother asked him to go backward.
So it's better to come forward, isn't it?
No, maybe for the latecomers it's easier to sit forward. Because the front door, the door opens from the front, so I think that's the wisdom. Anyway. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما صلوات Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullah. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. What a blessed week, inshallah, we've had, and what a blessed finishing of this week. Islamically, tonight is the end of the week, and today in the afternoon, our books of action that inshallah we'll talk about it had been given and had been shown to our present Imam, Imam Al-Hujjah Jalallah Farajahu Sharif. And inshallah, from the divine mercy of God, all what Imam Mahdi Ajjalallah Farajahu Sharif has seen in our book of action, Ya Rab, inshallah, had been nothing other than mourning, commemorating, weeping, crying, reading majlis, listening to majlis. And we have spent our nights, especially our nights, I'm sure, inshallah, in worshipping of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The talk that, please forgive me, but this water is very cold. It's if we can change it, something warmer. It blocked my throat. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ala. Inshallah, I'll be with you until next Friday evening. So one full week, inshallah, I'll be with you. And the topic that, or the topics that I have to share with you will be very much like series. You have watched movie series that you cannot afford missing one part, otherwise you will lose the track of it. This is not a commercial to whet your appetite to come every night, but please, it's important that inshallah you make an effort to come every night of that I'll be with you. Not only because I'm sure you don't want to treat me in Stockholm like Muslim in Aqil in Kufa, but also because we want to learn and connect all pieces of puzzles together so that we have our main objective. The main objective that inshallah will be heading throughout the nights is to respond to the call of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn, هَلْ مِنْ نَاصِرٍ يَنْصُرُنِي. Inshallah, I want to share with you proofs, enough evidences throughout the week that the call of Imam Hussein alayhi salam is still up and running and is there. The event of Karbala was not an event like commemoration or celebration of Mab'ath, the birth of the Prophet, and other Islamic events that we've had and we are celebrating that it took place some centuries ago. You want to use this one? Okay. Once again, sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Alright, it's not an event that took place and we are commemorating an event. Ashura is a living event. Ashura is quite similar to Laylatul Qadr. As inshallah we'll talk about it, Laylatul Qadr is not that it happened only at the time of the Prophet. Every year has its own Laylatul Qadr. And likewise, every year has its own Ashura. And therefore, every year the cry and the call of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, "Hal min nasirin yansuruni," is addressing all the lovers and the followers of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam, at least. Every night I'm sharing with you an ayah that is the theme of my talk. Inshallah, as usual, I appreciate if you repeat after me to wet your and to bless your mouth. And inshallah, I will explain my point throughout and around that ayah. The ayah for tonight, which is the most comprehensive and the shortest ayah in the Quran to introduce Islam in a nutshell. That if somebody tells you that give me the full description of Islam, but I don't have time to read the Quran, I don't have time to read 110 volumes of Bahar al-Anwar, give me in one line, one sentence. I would say that this is the answer that you can give in Surah Al-Anfal, Ayah 24. Don't quote me about the Ayah, you can easily find it, but I remember it's in Surah Al-Anfal. So I say the Ayah and please repeat after me. A'udhu billah min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. Istajibu lillahi walil rasool. إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ وَأَنَّهُ إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ صدق الله العلي العظيم. If you get a chance later on to reflect more on the ayah, to memorize it also, it will be better. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. Obviously, the ayah is addressing all of us, inshallah, as the believers in Islam, the believers in the Quran. Istajibu lillahi walil rasul. Respond to the call of God and to the call of the Prophet. First point is that the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking us to respond to the call of God and the Messenger, it means that we have not thoroughly and completely responded yet. Although we are believers and hence God is referring to us and addressing us as believers, but there is always, as we say, room to improve. Iqra warqa. Inshallah, this year we want to make sure that our faith in practice gets stronger than our faith last year during the month of Muharram. And the beauty of the second Ashara, the second 10 nights of Muharram, is that what we have learned in the first 10 nights and all what we have done in terms of all the emotions and education, we want to find applications for them, inshallah, in the second 10 nights of Muharram during these programs. That we have to make it, inshallah, more educational. So, استجيبوا لله وللرسول, it means don't be content with where you are standing Islamically. There is always room to elevate yourself. And in fact, you have no business in this world other than elevating yourself through faith and through righteous good deeds and practice, as we'll talk about it. Respond to the call of God and His Messenger. The reason that God mentions both of them, call of God and call of the Messenger, استجيبوا لله وللرسول, is to acknowledge His Messenger. Otherwise, the Messenger is not calling to Himself. Respond to the call of God, perhaps would be sufficient to say that, well, I don't have access to talk and listen to God to respond to Him. I hear God's commands through the Messenger. But deliberately, the Messenger is also mentioned to confirm and to acknowledge that when the Prophet is asking you something, he is asking for me, because none of the prophets called to themselves, none of the successors of the prophets also called to themselves. They were all calling to God, and they were all da'i Allah, as we'll talk about it. استجيبوا لله وللرسول إذا دعاكم. Also, when Quran says that respond to the call of God and the messenger, is telling us that on the other hand, negating any positive response to other than God, to other than the messenger of God. Yani, respond to the call of God and make sure that you don't respond to anything otherwise that is contrary to the call of God. Because so far as we are living in this world, brothers and sisters, inshallah, as you get older, you will experience it more, that there are constantly two kinds of invitations are coming to us. Possibly, with all respect to you, but at least the possibility was there. If not for me, because I don't know the city, because with my clothing and all this support, I don't have the opportunity, alhamdulillah, in a sense, some of you, with all respect, or some people that you know with all respect, tonight as Friday night is a going out night. I don't know about the Stockholm in Sydney, Friday night is going out night. Alright, it's the time that they, at the most innocent, so-called innocent things that they do, go watch a movie together. Alright, go to the city and things like that. Invite or go to a party, let's party together. Or let's put a movie at home and watch it together. Invitations are always there. There is an invitation always coming from Shaitan when you go to work. You are looking for a job. An invitation comes from Shaitan for the kind of the job. A sister, she was telling me that she is a web designer. And she said one of the questions that, Sheikh, I got a job offer to develop a website for a company that is a porno company. And because I wanted to avoid them, I gave them a crazy price, very crazy price. That I thought that they're gonna say, get lost, who's gonna pay that much? And guess what, they accepted it. So she said, what am I gonna do now? I said, no, don't give them any price. You go to work, and another one was saying that my boss gave me a champagne as a gift. And I took it and I said, I'm going to empty it, chuck it later on. I said, you should not have accepted it. She's muhajjabi, alhamdulillah. I said, you had an innocent and good intention, but you should educate the non-Muslims. Tell them that you will be offended to receive this. And you, as a Muslim, you cannot receive this. Invitations, especially for those living in the West, everywhere, of course, it has its own shape, form. But especially living in the West, I don't need to give you examples. You are living examples every day. Invitations of Shaitan, mashallah, constantly coming. Unfortunately, it seems that there is more satanic invitation than godly invitation in the West. And our children, the youth today, they don't have much options, Islamic options I'm talking about. How many majalis you had this year to go to? Limited programs, limited majalis. Whereas if you wanted to go otherwise, حدث ولا حرج ما شاء الله. So many opportunities. Quran quotes from the Shaitan. وقال الشيطان لما قضي الأمر. When the matter is all over. يعني after my death, after your death, after the trial is all over, then you will see Shaitan. We all see Shaitan. وقال الشيطان لما قضي الأمر. إن الله وعدكم وعد الحق. An email came to you as an example from Imam Ali's mosque. There was a heavenly invitation for Majlis al-Zikr, Majlis Imam Hussain alayhi salam. A friend of you invited you as well. وَوَعَدْتُكُمْ I also invited you. فَأَخْلَفْتُكُمْ And the difference is that when God promises you something, He fulfills. He delivers thoroughly. When Shaitan promises you something, His promises are empty promises. Okay? He's so good in deception. And all those who follow him, they have nothing other than deception. And hence people of Kufa, look at what happened. Because they followed Shaitan, they had to also deceive Imam Hussain alayhi salam and betray Imam Hussain alayhi salam. Because this is how Shaitan acts. Those who follow him, they do nothing other than this. فَأَخْلَفْتُكُمْ Then Shaitan says, do not come to me in Barzakh and say, لَعْنَتُ اللَّهِ Or in dunya, say, لَعْنَتُ اللَّهِ Hell on you, look at what you have done, look at the misery you've made for me. Shaitan says, وَمَا كَانَ لِي عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانِ Look, I had no authority, nobody forced you. It was a free country. Yes, true, you lived in Sweden, but it was a free country at the end of the day. It was your choice, my friend, whether you practice Islam or not practice Islam. You said, but it's tough, every job I'm looking for, the alcohol is involved and like that designer thing. Yes, opportunities are always there. Between brackets, brothers and sisters, let me tell you that if, especially when it comes to business, I get these questions a lot. Some brothers and sisters, when they say, Sheikh, it's very difficult here to find a halal job. Either I have to stay unemployed, remain at home, or if I have to look for a job, I have to close my eyes. Every minute I have to shake hand with a non-mahram, and you say that is haram. Forget about shaking hand. Now they come and they want to hug me. And what am I going to do? I tell them that, remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always testing our faith. If you are steadfast, if you say, no, I don't find a job, I don't want this job, that is haram. Rest assured that God is Ar-Razzaq and He will provide. It's just that you and I, we have to pass through tests of faith. Subhanallah, I've experienced it a lot in my life, a lot in my life. You're not live broadcasting, I suppose, is it? But unfortunately, this is my dilemma, that when I see that tomorrow I'm on YouTube, we have to censor ourselves, but what can we do? Let me share this with you, and I don't want to get off my topic. So many years ago in Australia, I had an interview with two immigration officers. Both of them happened to be ladies. I went to their office, private, and as I walked in, one of them, the main person who is interviewing, she stood up, and I was, alhamdulillah, with this attire. And subhanallah, sisters, I share this with you especially. Your dress codes, you won't believe it, it's an armor. It's a shield for you. Similar to us, with all respect to the brothers, when you are out, nobody can tell you are Muslim or not. By and large, alright? By your clothing, they can. But sisters, they can. Like me, I have experienced this in my life, subhanallah, wallah, so many times. That every time I'm going to somewhere very important, a very important conference, international forum or things, I make sure that always I go with this. I really see that I get more protected. If not because of myself, who cares about Mansoor Laghai? Because of the, you know what he's wearing. Resembles the prophetic clothing that we say. Alhamdulillah, I was in my armor, in my protecting shield. Wallah, it was a blessing from God, nothing from me at all. In a private room, and the immigration, two immigration officers, one of them, she stands up and she brings her hand from the other side of the desk to shake hand with you. It just crossed my mind, you know, sometimes you don't have time to think about it. Just crossed my mind. I put my hand on my head, on my heart, and I said, hi, how are you? And I sat down. We went through the interview, interrogation, whatever you want to call it, and all finished. When we got up to go, she said, do you have anything else to say? I said, yes, if I may, I have a comment. And that is that when I came and you wanted to shake with hand with me, and by the way, her hand was left like this. And I said to her that I didn't shake hand with you. I hope you didn't take offense to that. Let me explain myself that I had no intention of being offensive. It's just that in my religion, your hand belongs to your husband. I'm not allowed to come to skin touch with you. It's out of respect for the privacy. Behind your husband's back, I'm not allowed even to touch your hand, let alone hug you, let alone further, okay? And this is how Islam wants us to treat other females and things like that. Believe me, they looked at each other, both of them, and said, wow. Believe me, they were very much impressed. And she said, no, that's okay, actually, and anyway, it all finished. Now, in that situation, if I wanted to follow this, let me quote the rest of the ayah that I'm discussing to see that how we can bring it to our day-to-day transactions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, استجيبوا لله وللرسول. Respond to the call of God and the messenger when you go out, practically. We have come here to learn the techniques, Like you go to the gym to build your body so that you become strong against all viruses outside. Respond to the call of God. Then Quran says that if you don't, فَإِن لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا فَعْلَمُوا إِنَّمَا يَتَّبِعُونَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ وَمَنْ أَضَلْ مِمَّنْ يَتَّبِعُوا أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. Quran says if they don't respond to the call of God, rest assured that the only other option is respond to your whim and desire. And who is more lost than the one who follows his or her desire? Now, if in that situation, I wanted to say that nobody is around, nobody see me, there is no camera in front of me or anything, and immigration purposes, يعني التقيّة ديني ودين أباي وأجدادي, and trust me, as sheikhs, when you have a bit of education, Islamic education, that's a damage that can happen to us, unfortunately, that it's so easy to justify. Two people have noticed, they seen. One has a little bit of knowledge. Rahmatullah alayhi Ayatollah Gulbagani was saying that a bit of knowledge is always more dangerous than no knowledge. Qalilul ilm khatar. A bit of knowledge is dangerous. Because they have a bit of knowledge, they justify. Kullu makruhin ja'iz. Shaykh, it's not wajib. And now this is the situation of taqiyya. I know that my heart is clean and I don't have any evil intention. You know how shaitan plays with our mind. And Khali just shake hand with her and damn it, go on. What if tomorrow she cancels your visa and you go 10 years or so later, about 10 years later, throughout all those crises that you might be aware of, my lawyer had gone through my file and he told me that those two ladies that back then, I can't remember which year was it, back then they had interviewed you, that interview would determine whether you depart the country or you stay in the country. They had written such a good report on that interview, a very charismatic person and so, that unless that report was in your file, you had gone. So, do you see? And I had no idea, 10 years later I found out. And how many things in our lives that we never find out in dunya. Trust me, sisters, brothers, as someone few years at least older than you. Most of you are like my children age-wise. At least from an experience point of view, I share this with you. Just blindly, faithfully, put all your trust in God. Do what you have to do Islamically. You never regret it. Estajibu lillahi wa lirrasul idha da'akum. And no questions asked. No questions asked. Respond to the call of God when they are asking you. Wa'alamu anna allaha yahoolu bayna al-mar'i wa qalbi. By the grace of God, in the coming nights, I'll elaborate on this part more. But for the time being, let me just translate the ayah. Lo and behold, know that Allah yahulu, yani God becomes between you and your heart, between you and your intention. Before you intend something, before it crosses your mind, God knows about it. So I may be able to fool people with my speech, with my action, but I can fool myself with my intention because I know what is here in my mind. And more than that, I cannot, astaghfirullah, fool God. God knows what is crossing your mind before you know even about it. وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ. Because at the end of the day, you will be all resurrected to Him on the day. Because at the end of the day, there is a day of judgment. Therefore, do whatever you want to do, always considering life after death. وَأَنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ. The life of this dunya, poverty, richness, health, sickness, unemployed, employed, married, single, divorce, all are temporary situations and will pass. A believer is the one that remembers the end of this ayah. وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ. Do something that on the day of judgment you can defend your case, or your case is defended by your action. صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد. صل على محمد وعلى محمد. So what we are going to go through, inshallah, in the coming nights is learning about how we can respond to the call of God and to the call of the Messenger of God. And the call of Imam Hussein, as we say, is the call of the Messenger and the call of God. Brief, in a nutshell, until I just unfold it, inshallah, thoroughly as my time will allow in the coming nights. Response that God wants from you and I, response that Imam Hussein alayhi salam wants from all of us, is to practice this ayah, Man amila salihan, in Surah Al-Nahl, chapter 16. Man amila salihan min dhakarin aw untha wa huwa mu'min falanuhyiyannahum hayatan tayyibah. Those who want to have a pure and clean life in dunya and especially in akhirah, all what requires is that man amila salihan, make sure that you are among those who are doing righteous good deeds. Man dhakara wa untha, it doesn't matter male or female. In the realm of divinity, there is no gender involved. Male, whoever you may be. Wa huwa mu'min, while you are a believer. Inshallah, tomorrow we'll learn about how we can elevate the level of our faith, or maybe a few nights, and then we focus on amal salih, on the good action. What are the good actions and the reality of the good actions? From the time of Prophet Ibrahim, we have these. We have this in a hadith for the Prophet of Islam, obviously. We have this for Imam al-Hujjah al-Jalallah Farajul Sharif. All Anbiya and Awliya and Awsiya, each and every one of them, they were Da'i Allah. They were all calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were all called Da'i Allah. When Prophet Ibrahim is building Kaaba, the Holy Kaaba, and he's asking, رَبِّ بَجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ, make the heart of people inclined towards this. Every year until the day of judgment, everyone goes to Hajj. This is labbaik to the call of Prophet Ibrahim. And of course, the call of Prophet Ibrahim was the call of God. And therefore, he's da'i Allah. There is a ziyarah, visitation for Imam Hussein alayhi salam, from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, in a very authentic book known as Kamil al-Ziyarat. In that, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says that anytime you want to go visit my grandfather Imam Hussein alayhi salam, there are some etiquettes to meet. Remember, was it here I mentioned last night that from Ayatollah Bahjat that says that wherever there are banners for Imam Hussein alayhi salam is a branch of the haram of Imam Hussein. So here we can consider it definitely a branch of the haram, the holy shrine of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein. Again, I go to footnote quickly. I remember some years ago we had a couple, Rahmatullah alayhi, the husband has passed away now. Every time they used to come to the center, Imam Hussein Center in Sydney, they used to kiss the door. They used to kiss the door and then come in. Once somebody commented and said, Hajj, this is not haram. You're not going to the haram. He said, no, for me, this is the haram. And really, they used to make 2.5 hours, spend 2.5 hours by train, by bus, to get to the center, attend the programs and go. And he said, I cannot go to Karbala, I cannot go to Najaf, but this is my Karbala Najaf. I know that from here, because the holy name of Imam Hussein is above this. Here, the holy name of Imam Ali is there. It's at the end of the day, your intention. أُقَبِّلُ ذَا الْجَدَارَ وَذَا الْجَدَارَ وَمَا حُبُّ الدِّيَارَ شَغَفْنَ قَلْبِي وَلَكَنْ حُبُّ مَنْ سَكَنَ الدِّيَارَ. Piece of wood here, there, everywhere is piece of wood. Once it's related to Imam Hussein, it becomes holy. Anyway, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says that anytime you want to go, إِذَا أَتَيْتَ الْقَبْرِ, when you come to the grave, when you come to the haram of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, one of the etiquettes is that هَلِّلِ اللَّهَ سَبْعًا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ أذكار, you say that as you slowly walking towards the haram. Then أحمد الله الحمد لله الحمد لله الحمد لله سبح الله سبحان الله سبحان الله until the Imam says ثم then what you need to say, then you say the لبيك, you أجب الحسين سبعا تقول, 7 times you answer Imam Hussein alayhi salam. This is استجيبوا لله وللرسول. You answer Imam Hussein alayhi salam. تقول لبيك يا داعي الله لبيك يا داعي الله لبيك يا داعي الله 7 times. لبيك يا داعي الله is that استجيبوا لله وللرسول. Respond, I'm here. يا ابن رسول الله يا حسين, I'm here at your service. What do you want from me? What is your expectations from me? I want to be among the lovers of Hussein. What is your expectation from me? And then the Imam says, you add, you say that, in lam yujibka badani. If I wasn't alive in the year 61 and I wasn't in Ashura, in Karbala, to be able to sacrifice myself for you, now I'm here in Sweden, in Stockholm. Now that, and I hear that Ashura revives every, comes every year. Ashura is not like the prophetic birth. Ashura is not the birth anniversary of Amirul Mu'mineen that we are celebrating an occasion. Ashura is a river, an ongoing river. Every year we have Ashura. Ya Hussein, what is your expectation from me? What is it that you want me to do in Stockholm to find my role? Hal min nasirani ansurani, does it apply to me as well? Look at this proof, and I'm happy to, if anyone can wants to challenge it. When Imam Hussein alayhi salam, before he leaves Medina, he left his final will. A piece of document, alhamdulillah, we have access to it. Few lines only. Clearly, he says that you don't need to do ijtihad to find out what was my mission. Just quote me correctly and my message is delivered. And the Imam says that innama kharajtu li talab al islah fi ummat jaddi. Very often we have heard of this. I am standing against Yazid because I want to make reformation in the community of my grandfather. Question: the community of the grandfather of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, was it only those who were living at that time? Aren't we members of the Ummat Muhammad sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad? So for sure we are members of the community of Islam as well, Islamic Ummah. If that's the case, Imam Hussein alayhi salam still is telling you and I, ya Sheikh, ya Fulan, ya Sheikh, ya old, ya brother, innama kharajtu li talab al islah. So Hurr ibn Yazid became one of the members of the Shuhada, and his name is now glittering because right within, in the morning of Ashura, he started that Islah, that reformation, that change within himself. Impossible for you and I, or for anyone, if I want to correct my children, if I want to correct the community, I have to start from within, I have to start from myself. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu qu anfusakum din wa ahlikum. First, safeguard yourselves. A father who is browsing on the net in his private room and comes out, tells his son, what are you doing? What are you listening to? And then he doesn't care what he's listening to, what is he watching. He's just ridiculing himself. He's not going to save his children. Okay? So, إِنَّمَا خَرَجْتُ لِطَلَبِ الْإِصْلَاحِ, it means that for you and I today also we have to make a reformation. No matter who you are, no matter where you are standing, that inshallah in the coming nights you are going to examine, cross-examine our faith. Have a second view on our faith to see how faithful we are. Just a quick commercial for tomorrow night. Think of this ayah for tomorrow. This ayah that Quran says, وَمَا يُؤْمِنُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ إِلَّا وَهُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ. Most of those who give lip service to Islam and they say that they are believers, in reality they are mushrikun. They are disbelievers. We want to find out tomorrow whether it applies, God forbid, to me and to which level it does. Inshallah, until then, sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا ابن رسول الله يا هلالا لما استتم كمالا غاله خسفه فأبدى غروبا بلغ العلا بكماله كشف الدجى بجماله. Let us tonight follow the caravan of Ahlul Bayt عليهم السلام. The so-called caravan of captives of war. As they arrived the city of Kufa. Kufa was the capital of the government of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. So Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam had lived in this city. People of Kufa knew Ahlul Bayt well. Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha, she used to run classes of Quran, Islamic teaching, narrating to the ladies, running courses. They were familiar with her voice and with her face. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Deliberately, Umar Sa'd al-La'in kept the family of Ahlul Bayt, the ladies, children, behind the city of Kufa last night until today after sunrise in front of the eyes of the public, bring them to the town. Now you imagine Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam, who is also so ill, Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha, all the rest of the ladies and children, they are all wrapped together and are brought, pulled to the city, and deliberately they are crossing them through the middle of the town, through the bazaar, so that everybody can see them. And they are beating the trumpet, saying that these are the captives of war. As a normal practice, some prisoners of war have come to the city. Ignorant people, ladies, women, they came with pieces of bread, loaf of bread, given to the children, to the ladies. And Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha, she's running around and asking the kids, although they are hungry, she's asking them that, children, my dears, don't take anything from them. Inna sadaqata alayna haram. Charity is forbidden on us. Charity is forbidden on you. A lady turned around and looked at Sayyidah Zainab. Min ayyi usara antunna. From which captives of war? What kind of captives are you that you don't take charity? Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha, she goes, Nahnu usara ali Muhammad. Ana Zainab bint Fatima bint Rasulillah. My name is Zainab, the daughter of Fatima, the daughter of the Prophet. We are the direct family of the Prophet. Look at what has happened to us. Ladies, women of Kufa, men, they started wailing and crying. And Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam says, look at this hypocrisy. They killed us and they yanuhuna alayna, another weeping and crying on us. The scene continues until they go to the court of Ibn Ziyad. That La'in, Allahu Akbar. Imagine now the scene that the caravan arrives in the court of Ubaidullah Ibn Ziyad al-La'in, Ibn Marjan. They are all accommodated at one corner, and Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha, who was wearing a worn clothes, she hid herself between her female slaves and maids, so that she knows what kind of person Ibn Ziyad is. But her glory could be seen, you know, from even her worn clothes. And therefore, Ubaidullah Ibn Ziyad al-La'in looked at that corner and says, who is that woman sitting there? No answer. Second time and third time, one of her maids, she turns around and said, هذه مولاتي زينب بنت علي هذه زينب بنت فاطمة. And a battle begins, the battle of a speech between Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad and Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha. That, brothers, you can see their bravery because of their faith, standing in front of such a ruthless person, and see how brave this lady is. A lady that the narrator says, Wallah lam ara khafiratan qat. I have never seen a woman that has lost her children, her brothers, her nephews. Anyone in that situation would have no more strength. But she says, he says that I've never seen a lady that has been going through so much calamity, yet look how strong she is. Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad al-La'in, he looks at her and he tries to be spiteful. He says, Alhamdulillah alladhi iftadahakum wa akdhaba uhduthatakum. كيف رأيت فعل الله بأخيك لعنة الله عليه. He says, Alhamdulillah that God proved it that you are liars. Alhamdulillah that God disgraced you, meaning that your family, your brother, your master. Immediately Sayyid Zainab salamullah alayha, she turns around looking at him and he says, إِنَّمَا يَفْتَضِحُ الْفَاسِغُ وَهُوَ أَنْتْ يَبْنَ مَرْجَانَ. So strong. Do you know who is disgraced? It is you, the one whose father is unknown. Talking to such a ruthless person like this. And it is you. And then she continues. She says that they are the ones that they are now enjoying their lives in paradise. Elevated in paradise. But time will come, Yabna Marjana, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring you to the court of justice and you will be asked about every single one of them that what you had done to them. And you want to see how I see what God, what has happened? Ma ra'aytu illa jameela. I have seen but a beauty. Because it's all coming from God. We see the wisdom. You are going to be perished. Ibn Ziyad was speechless and he doesn't have any more to say, and therefore what he did, he tried to be spiteful in action, pointed at one of his slaves, and la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. A tray was brought to the court, and you imagine Sukaina is there, Fatima, daughters of Imam Hussein, Ruqayya, all ladies are there. Really these scenes, brothers and sisters, we just narrated really. But if we visualize it, it's traumatizing. How possibly can one see the head of her father? Let me just open a bracket here. Many years ago in Iran, one of my friends, indirect friend, he was martyred during the war against Saddam at the time of Iran-Iraq war. And they brought the body of this shaheed to the city, to Isfahan, for the funeral. Before the procession began, the family of Shaheed came among them. His sister came. It's quite mustahab for the last time before they bury the mayyit to open the face and look at the face. You are familiar perhaps that people, the relatives come and farewell the person. The sister of this Shaheed was insisting that she said she wanted to see one more time her brother. And the authorities would say, no, it's not permissible. No, no, it's not. Until one of the scholars, he goes and he's talking to them, says, what's wrong with that? She will be relieved. Please give her the chance. Let her see her brother. It's her brother. Let her see her brother one more time. They said, no, no, it's not possible. And after insisting, they said, Shaykhuna, this Shaheed is headless. She cannot stand the scene. If we remove the coffin, the shroud, she will not be able to stand the scene. Now you imagine what happens to Sayyid Zainab. What happens to Sukaina, to Raqqaya, when that mal'oon brings the head of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein, and even on the top of that, La'natullah alayhi, with his stick starts hitting the lips of Abu Abdullah. Ala la'natullah ala al-qawm al-zalimin. وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْغَلَبٍ يَنْغَلَبُونَ. Please be conscious of your hawa'ij, all the marda, the quickly appearance of Imam al-Hujjah Jalallah Farajul Sharif, good ending in dunya, inshallah resurrection with Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam in akhirah, forgiveness of our sins. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء بجاه محمد وآل محمد وبحرمة الفاتحة مع الصلوات يا أرحم الراحمين يا
Can we have Q&A now?
Who is the chairperson? Do we have If there is any questions or comment, I'm at your service.
Kan även ställa frågor högt. Vi har inte delat ut papper och penna nu. Om ni har skrivit ner på någonting så kan vi ta emot det. Eller om man vill bara säga högt. Vi har en kvart, inshallah, för frågor och svar.
Salam alaikum, shaykh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Today you say to in Salat Jama'ah about taqwa.
No.
A hadith of Imam Bakr, right?
No.
You can repeat it.
Yes, inshallah.
What's the meaning of taqwa?
Okay, yeah. Taqwa, Imam Baqir alayhi salam was asked about the definition of taqwa, and the Imam says, Allah yafqudaka haythu amarak, wala yaraka haythu nahak. Taqwa, in a nutshell, so precisely, it means that God should not miss you where He's expecting to see you, and He should not see you when you are prohibited to be. This is the definition of taqwa. And because everything that we do is going to be in a place, in a space in dunya, so the space that a sin is committed, we should not be seen on that space. Space that God is worshipped, we are expected to be seen on that space, on that space. So, no questions, comments? It's coming, yeah. Please write it in English, not Swedish. Yes, brother.
Two questions, but I can take the first one. What should be the purpose for mourning about the Imam Hussein?
Purpose for mourning for Imam Hussein alayhi salam? The purpose, I'll tell you one thing. Maybe last year we spoke about this and therefore I didn't repeat it, but very common question. Mourning for Imam Hussein alayhi salam, al-aza, for the loved one, doesn't need any reason, to be very honest with you. Yani, you don't, if, like, I give example of myself, because both my parents have passed away. My mother died in front of my eyes, okay? When we lose a dear, like mother, father, normal even in bed, natural death, so to speak, it's natural to be in tears. You don't sit and say that, okay, the purpose of, what is the purpose for crying? And you do your calculations, come to a conclusion, and then, okay, now go on. It comes. Yeah, this is the story of love. Love, and unfortunately, the other side of it, hatred sometimes like this as well, but let's focus on love. Love with someone doesn't have any reason. You don't know why you fall in love. And part of the love is that you get emotional, missing that person. So one aspect of mourning for Imam Hussein alayhi salam should be very natural, not superficial. Yani it's not that I force myself. Yes, we have to somehow force ourselves to relate to it, to be able to get to that natural level. But first is natural reaction to someone that you love. Second, benefits. So what I would rather to say, benefits of mourning for Imam Hussein alayhi salam, it tightens your relation with Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam through the bridge of love, with tears that you shed, relation every night that you are spiritually feeding your heart with the love of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein, with listening to the majlis, crying for Imam Hussein, your relation with Imam Hussein alayhi salam and Ahlul Bayt gets stronger, and that's all what we want. Once you have that love connection between you and Ahlul Bayt, inshallah one night I speak about it particularly, you will see that following the footsteps becomes so easy and willing. Yeah, that you enjoy it to follow them. In as much as Imam Ali, because he was in love with the Prophet, he said that I was following him like a baby camel following his mother. With joy and happiness you did, not with force. Like when you love your teacher, you love that subject. You hate that teacher, you hate that subject. This is the power of love. So mourning for Imam Hussein alayhi salam has that message in individually for me as well. There are some external aspects to it as well and benefit as well that you affect on others. I had invited a priest to our center some years ago, right on the day of Ashura. And you know, day of Ashura is the day of Maqtal. We usually read Maqtal. And when I was there, I used to read Maqtal in Farsi, Arabic and English, mixing them all up. This priest was sitting and he told me himself after the program was over, imagine we had two-story building, downstairs all men, upstairs all women, and during the Maqtal everybody was crying. When we were outside for lunch, he said that, Mansoor, it really touched me. I could see like the whole building is crying. And because he was there, mind you, that I had added the English a little bit more so that he can relate. So just sitting and listening to the crowd, and the same priest, by the way, they told me that this year he had come and the reciter was reading the majlis for Subhanallah for Abdullah al-Radi Ali al-Asghar. And they told me that Father Day was there and he was this time crying. First time that I had invited him, he didn't say that he cried. He just said that I felt for Hussein. This time, 4 or 5 years later, he comes and he cries. So it has impact on others. Not that you do it to impress others. You be yourself. But it has those positive side effects, inshallah, as well. Let me keep it short so that... Do you want to ask the second question as well, brother? You said... Okay.
I just wonder, how can we protect ourselves from the... I can say there's a hadith from Imam Ja'far Salah says, don't be a disgrace for us. And by disgrace, I understand that
كونوا لنا زينا ولا تكونوا علينا شينا. That's the hadith you're referring to, that the Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says that in your social relation, be in such a way that you become an adornment for us. That when the people they see you, they say, Rahimallah Ja'far ibn Muhammad, laqad addaba ashaba. May the blessing of God be on Imam Sadiq. See how he has disciplined his followers and the lovers. That's very correct. That's why our action matters a lot outside, especially for us that we are living as minorities within a major non-Islamic community, society. Unfortunately, it has been always like this, and I'm sure you have seen today's brothers and sisters. You just go Google search and type Ashura and see what comes up. There is, of course, a conspiracy behind it. We all know that Ashura is not all about this tatbir and things like that, or going perhaps to the extreme. But there is a propaganda against us already. We don't need to send fuel to their fire. There is already a fire against us, my friend. You don't need to add fuel to it. I remember when I was like a teenager, back then tatbir existed. But tatbir was more of a personal, private, secret practice. That someone would make a vow, He would go to the basement of his house. Between him and God, he was doing it. Right or wrong, it was a personal, private practice. They were doing it for some. Now, coming to the street, bringing it to the street, well, but unfortunately, the more we talk about it, it seems that the more some people are stubborn against, and they were adamant, they said, no, this is my love for Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Once I was talking somewhere, and I said that Imam Ali alayhi salam, he used to hit the head of the enemies, and we hit our head. If you're really strong enough, alhamdulillah, mashallah, go to North Iraq and stand against the enemies of God. Go further north and stand against all those Zionists and use your sword against them. Yani, anyway, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Wallah, brother, it's not in my hand to reward or punish anyone, but I'm talking from my understanding and from to the best of my knowledge. I tell you one thing, that all our fuqaha are unanimous. At least there's a common ground on certain issues. This that I'm telling you is a common ground. All right? The benchmark is here, that anything that yujibu al-wahna ala al-deen, any action that is causing really like belittling the religion, is not permissible. So it's really the individual's decision and judgment. What I'm doing, am I causing any like belittling of my madhab, or I am not? Yeah, you're welcome. The last straw that I have against them, I tell them that, is this, can you give me any hadith, anything that this is mustahab, this is wajib? Obviously it's not wajib. Otherwise, all our maraja had to do it as well. Can you tell me that this is mustahab practice? If it's mustahab, halal Muhammadin, halal la yawm al-ghi. There would have been a hadith somewhere, even non-authentic hadith, that any of the imams, they used to do this tatbir. You can say it's even mustahab. Now that it's mustahab, take the precaution, my friend. With all the commotion going on around the world, take the precaution. Why are you insisting to bring it to the public and in front of all the cameras?
In the speech you just said in your speech, in a sense that then I'm going to Mazar-e Kufa, and she said, you people killed us and you make this crime. So that all the Sunni people say, the Shia people kill and they are Zainab. Give him badua. They are always crying like this. Then you told in this speech.
Sorry, I'm just quoting Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam, by the way. But Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam doesn't say, and we don't say, that the true Shia, and they were really Shia as the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they killed Imam Hussein. People of Kufa at the time of Karbala, they were divided into 3-4 different categories, and they were all living. Iraq is a very, and Arabic countries, very tribal countries, and still very tribal, different qabail. We had mawaleen, that mainly they were new Muslims. We had the lovers of Ahlul Bayt, just lovers, but Uthmaniyin even. Yani they would love the Khulafa before Imam Ali, but they used to love Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi alayhi salam as well. And they were good Shia as well. Good Shia like Hani ibn Urwa, good Shia like Inshallah Mukhtar, good Shia like Abdullah ibn Afif, as I will mention his tragedy, Inshallah, that they, or even Habib Muslim, that they managed to get to Karbala and help Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Yes, there were some Shia by names as well. So what you can say, it's not that the distinction of Shia and Sunni that we have today didn't exist back then that clearly as we have it now. All right. If any of the Sunnis, they say that you're Shia, not Sunnis, they killed Imam Hussein alayhi salam, and no one from Sham came to fight Imam Hussein, that's correct. No one from Sham had the chance to come. And Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad, both the like the normal people who were in Kufa. We say that we are not talking about Shia by name. We are talking because some of them, for sure, they were the lovers of Ahlul Bayt. But Hubb al-Dunya deceived them. Or the threat of Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad deceived them. and they got to Karbala. In the same way that it's not the Shia Sunni issue. Are all Sunnis now pious, practicing good Muslims? Not obviously. Not the same for Shia. Called so-called Shia, not the same for Sunni. Let me read some of the questions. Yesterday you mentioned to respect the verse of Bishra. So we can have an open heart. What does this? Allahumma shrah li sadri. Let me see what does she say. Yesterday you mentioned to respect the verse Allahumma rabbishrah. If you want to read the ayah, rabbishrah li sadri. So can have an open heart. What does I think she's asking what does Rabbi Shrah li sadri means? Rabbi Sharh Sad means expansion of the heart. Expansion of the heart, we're not talking about this heart in the body. This is not a medical thing that you're asking, all right? Expansion of the heart, yani that you have a big heart in the sense that you're not mean. Those who are mean are those that is they finding it difficult to forgive. Whereas the one who has Sharh Sad has a big heart, she can easily forgive. It's not difficult for her to forgive. That's what we mean by Sharh Sad, opening and expansion of the heart.
The final question.
Yani expansion of our tolerance, if you like to call it also.
Final question.
Was it the final question? Okay. The rest, inshallah, any of the brothers or sisters that I didn't get a chance to ask their to answer their questions, kindly you can email it to me and I will definitely respond. And my email, you don't have a screen here, sheikh@ehouse.com. That's my email. Last question, inshallah, I read for now. Assalamu alaikum. You told yesterday that our should give good forgiveness to what extent over forget for every compelling one individual was caused to prophecy in my family for it to be possible to forget what should one do. There is no situation, sister, that is impossible to forgive. There is always possibility for forgiveness. And I understand that some situations are more severe, but in a nutshell, really, in general, when we are talking about issues within the family, within the community, not with the enemies of God, okay? Even though their action is definitely evil, between you and God is always best for you, even if you don't want to inform them, it's better for you to forgive them and pray for them even. That may God wake her up to herself or wake him up to himself. But as far as I'm concerned, Ya Rab, I client my conscience and my heart about them. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So I keep these questions, but I didn't get a chance to answer them. I don't want to sit behind. I don't want to take the time of everybody. If those who didn't get the answer for the questions, they like to come and I answer them. Or if you remember my email, do you think that you would remember?
Sure. Can we save them for tomorrow, inshallah?
Yeah, because tomorrow I'm sure that its questions will be coming as well. But still, all right, bear with me, inshallah, for tomorrow. Ahsan.